The more technology you have in your life, the less free you are. So for example, because there are microphones here, that means that I will now be standing here for the next hour, when what I would prefer to do is walk around and make eye contact with you and so on. So I have to stand here. You, on the other hand, can stand up and mill around and get coffee if you want. I would like to thank Anna Mostovych and her professionals association for this invitation. I'm very glad to be at this beautiful site. I'm very glad to be in Chicago. And I'm appreciative to you, those of you from Chicago, and also those of you who came from further afield. I know some of you did. This is a difficult book to introduce, and I'd like to introduce it by way of what's most important to me, namely the individuals who are its subject. In early 1933, in what was then Soviet Ukraine, a young man dug his grave. The reason he dug his grave was that he was sure that he was going to die of starvation. He was right. The other reason he dug his own grave was that he knew that once he died, his body would lie in a field or by the side of the road until it was picked up, thrown in the back of a cart, and then dumped with a number of other corpses in a mass grave where there would be no marker. So he knew that he was going to die, but he wished to preserve some element of dignity. So he dug his own grave. And then when the day came, he went there. In April of 1940, in a bit of forest that later became notorious, Katyn, a Polish officer was keeping a diary. It was coming to the end of his diary because he was coming to the end of his life. In the second to last entry of his diary, he wrote about his wedding ring. He wrote, "They asked me for my wedding ring, which I," and then it trails off. He probably hid the wedding ring. The NKVD men who executed him almost certainly found it. We don't have his ring, but we do have his diary. In early 1943 in Kovel, which, as you all know, is now western Ukraine, Volhynia province, the Germans had sealed the synagogue. It was coming to the end of the final solution. The Jews who were still alive knew at that point perfectly well what was going to happen to them. And so they took to writing notes on the walls of the synagogue with whatever they could, with knives, with bits of glass or stone. And one of them, a young woman, wrote a note to her mother. She was there with her sisters, and she said, "We are so sorry we can't be with you. We kiss you over and over." The difficulty of a book like this is the difficulty of the history that it's meant to tell, which is the difficulty of the 20th century, I think. Namely, these are three of 14 million people. Three of 14 million people who were deliberately murdered between 1933 and 1945 in a relatively small part of the world between the Black and the Baltic Seas, between about Poznań and Smolensk, in the lands that I call the Bloodlands. It's a very striking number, I take it, 14 million. It's a very large number. It's a number which I think demands our attention. But it's a number which is significant, I think, beyond its sheer weight, beyond the sheer scale of the tragedy. For after all, we are, I take it, most of us, if not all of us, interested in Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union, and in particular, the most terrible aspects of the policies of Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union. We're all interested in why and how those two regimes killed so many people. This number of 14 million is a number of people who were killed by both the Nazi and the Soviet regimes. But it's important not only in its absolute size, it's also important in a relative sense. It's important in a relative sense because these 14 million are such a tremendous share of a total number of people killed by the Nazis and the Soviets. What I'm going to be talking about today is a very small part of the world, a relatively confined part of Europe. It's a part of Europe which is familiar to you as well as to me. But if you imagine, if we move beyond what I call the Bloodlands, which are today's Ukraine, Belarus, most of Poland, Western Russia, the Baltics, if you move beyond that with me just for a moment and imagine the entire territory which the Soviets and the Germans ruled together, it would range from France to Siberia, right, from Normandy, let's say, to Vladivostok. Over that entire territory, the two regimes killed something like 17 million people. So of those 17, 14 million were killed in this very small band, this very small area, which I'm calling the Bloodlands. So if we understood this mass killing, we might not only learn something about the victims and their lives and the way their lives were brought to an end, but we might learn something about the two regimes. Because if so much of their killing happened in this land, this must have been a land which was in some way important to them as well. Now, I define the Bloodlands in one way already. That is, this is a territory where 14 million lives were brought to an end. And to be clear, I'm only talking about non-combatants. I'm not talking about the war itself. The 14 million excludes casualties of war. If you included casualties of war, you would also find that this was the most dangerous place to be in the world. About half of the military casualties in the entire Second World War, in all of its theaters, took place in the same land. But my 14 million is only people who were not on the battlefield. It's only civilians and prisoners of war. So I've already defined the Bloodlands in one way. It's where 14 million people were murdered. Interestingly, there are two other definitions which generate exactly the same bit of territory. The Bloodlands are also where the Holocaust took place. This was the land where the largest concentration of Jews in Europe and in the world lived. Unsurprisingly, in that sense, it's where the Holocaust happened. When we think of the Holocaust, you might think of German Jews. But German Jews were a relatively small percentage of its victims. They were a relatively small group of world Jewry. Most Jews in the world lived precisely here, and this is where the Holocaust took place. So another way to think about this number, 14 million, is to put it together with the number of 5.7 million, which is about how many Jews were murdered in the Holocaust, in the same place and time, roughly, where the Holocaust took place, about 8.5 million people who were not Jewish were also murdered, which is a striking observation. If you just think, in the time that Hitler and Stalin were in power, 6 million, 5.7 million Jews were murdered, and about 8.5 million non-Jews were murdered in the same place. That seems to require that we stop and think about possible relationships between the ways these people's lives were brought to an end. That's one of the things the book tries to do. So those are two definitions of the Bloodlands, where 14 million people were killed, where the Holocaust took place. And there's a third definition. The third definition is the part of Europe where both Nazi and Soviet power were present, right? So obviously there are vast parts of Europe, Eurasia, where Soviet power was present, but German power never was, most of the Soviet Union. There are considerable parts of Europe where Nazi power was present, but Soviet power never was, France, the Low Countries, Scandinavia, and so on. And terrible things happened in those places. But the territory where I'm talking about, the territory I'm describing here, was a place that was touched by the power of both regimes. So it's interesting to me and very suggestive that those three definitions generate pretty much exactly the same spot of territory. So let's assume for the sake of argument that everything I've said so far is accurate. And true, it is. So far, all I've given you so far is really elementary material, really. It's all just been arithmetic and geometry, right? Or sorry, arithmetic and geography. It's all just been numbers and maps, which admittedly, like in the present moment of American culture, is not our strong point. But it's all been numbers and maps. So if this simple observation is true, that 14 million people were murdered in a relatively confined area over a relatively short period of time, why has this not been observed before, right? Why am I standing here and saying this now as opposed to someone saying it 40 years ago or 20 years ago? Or to put it in a slightly more dramatic way, given that this mass murder, given that this series of murderous policies which brought an end to the lives of 14 million people took place, given that this was the worst catastrophe in the history of the modern West, quite possibly, why does it have no history? How can there be an event of such a scale and of such horror without there being a history of it? So that's the first thing I'd like to try to share with you, my thoughts about why no one else wrote this book, which for the Polish minority in the audience, whenever I go to Poland and I do media interviews, the first things that they ask, the first thing that the media interviewer always asks me is, why didn't a Pole write your book? Which those of you who are familiar with the Polish national psychology will understand immediately. But it's a hard question to answer. Why didn't someone else write your book? But in this particular case, I think it's worth pausing and asking, why didn't someone else write this book? Or why wasn't this problem seen as a problem? Part of it, of course, is that there are histories that touch on this catastrophe. There are huge bodies of historical literature that touch upon these 14 million deaths. The problem is that they're divided up. They're divided up into three groups, and the three groups don't really touch each other. You have certainly national histories of suffering, be they Ukrainian or Polish or Lithuanian, or Russian or Lithuanian or Latvian or Estonian. You have the history of Soviet terror, and you also have the history of the Holocaust. To put the point very simply, you can read a lot of those histories without realizing that they happen at the same place and at the same time. And if you don't realize from reading the books that they happen at the same place and the same time, then you won't ask what the relationship between them might have been. And you certainly won't ask, as I try to ask in this book, if in some sense they aren't part of some larger history that could be described as such. So one way to think about the problem is that you have three histories that are moving along in parallel. But of course, parallel lines never touch, right? Or as truly pedantic students of geometry might say, they only touch at infinity, but that's in the long run and all of that. But in a way, it's worse. It's not just that the lines run in parallel. There's another metaphor which might be more accurate, and that is to say that they not only don't touch, they repel each other. If you try to put the history of different kinds of national suffering together, you will get a good deal of resistance. It's not a natural move to make because the different national historiographies define the good guys and the bad guys rather differently. And someone's liberator has a way of being someone else's oppressor. Someone's liberatory national movement has the way of being someone else's ethnic cleanser, and so on. It's very hard to just take the national... You can't, in fact, just take the national histories and put them together and come up with an overall European history. There's another magnetic opposition in play here too, and that is of a more political, more abstract character, and that has to do with Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union. In general, this is probably not true for many of you, but in general, when we write or talk about Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union, it's as though they were on different planets. Whereas in fact, in the most relevant sense of the exertion of their power, they were present in the same time and place. Between 33 and 45, in the Bloodlands, the Germans and the Soviets were both present. They simply were, as everyone who lived there or died there knew. But the whole way that the French Revolution has structured our political minds, which was then confirmed in the 1930s, confirmed again, I think, by the end of the Cold War, that we divide between right and left, that we imagine that these two systems somehow are irreconcilable, makes it hard to put them together, which makes a history of this kind very difficult. There aren't that many people who would just find it natural to write about the presence of the Soviets and then the presence of the Nazis. In general, histories follow Nazi Germany or they follow the Soviet Union and thereby leave out the obvious moments of interaction. So these are some of the shortcomings of these literatures, all of which were, of course, very important to me. I want to stress that I couldn't possibly have written a book without these literatures. Unfortunately, there's at least one other thing which has to be said, and that is that inside each of these literatures, there's a problem. So with respect to East European history, the problem is that it is national, which is, of course, understandable. There's a lot of national history still to be done. But what happens with national history is that you often don't see the whole scale of a problem. So 3 million Polish Jews died, but you can't really understand the Holocaust by writing Polish history from a Polish point of view. Many Ukrainians died in the Great Terror, but you can't understand the Great Terror just by writing from a Ukrainian point of view, and so on. The problem with Soviet history, about which we've learned a huge amount, and I've learned a huge amount from colleagues working in Soviet history, The problem with Soviet history, though, is that it tends to be centrist. It tends to be concentrated in Moscow, which is perfectly understandable. Moscow is very important. But you don't very often get the sense from reading Soviet history that the truly murderous or the most murderous acts of the regime were around the periphery, in East Asia, Central Asia, the Caucasus, and also in Eastern Europe, that is Ukraine and Belarus, the parts of the Soviet Union that I'm calling the Bloodlands. The Holocaust has a similar problem. The problem with the Holocaust historiography, which is the most impressive, by the way, the most sophisticated by far of all of these literatures, is that it tends to try to contain a much larger problem within the framework of German history. And of course, German history and the history of anti-Semitism is indispensable for understanding the Holocaust. But on the other hand, 97% of the victims of the Holocaust didn't know the German language. The Holocaust is something which took place entirely beyond the borders of pre-war Germany. And understanding it requires, I think, other points of view as well. I think it requires moving beyond a point of view which considers it as a kind of decline and fall of German civilization. Or to put it in a slightly, I hope, more precise way, the way that Holocaust books about the Holocaust generally function is that you have part one, which is about 33 to 39, in Nazi Germany, the accumulation of political anti-Semitism, and then you have part two, 39 to 45, which is about the Holocaust. The problem with this is that the part one doesn't really explain part two very well. Part one is generally about political anti-Semitism, but if political anti-Semitism were enough to cause a Holocaust, there should have been a Holocaust in Germany before 1939. Which there wasn't. There was only a Holocaust after the Germans went to war and started to build their empire, which are very important considerations, I think. But those are considerations that only start to come clear and come into focus when you look at the territory as a whole, which is what I try to do. So what do I try to do in this book, which is perhaps a bit different from previous books? The first thing I try to do is avoid metaphysics, which I don't do completely. As a very close reading Romanian friend and colleague has already noted in a book review, God appears in chapter 4. So I don't entirely avoid metaphysics. But what I mean is that I try very hard to avoid the secular metaphysics of the 20th century. What do I mean by the secular metaphysics of the 20th century? The first thing I mean is national exceptionalism. So the idea, implicit or explicit, that it's sufficient to just write about one group, or to put one group in the foreground and see where that takes you. I don't do that. For me, the subject of this book is the 14 million people who were murdered. They were Jews, they were Ukrainians, they were Poles, and sometimes that's the reason why they were murdered, although not always. And it's important to remember that it wasn't how they thought about themselves that led them to be murdered, it was how other people thought of them that led them to be murdered. But I don't start this project from the point of view that I'm writing about Jews or Ukrainians or Poles. I start the project from the observation that 14 million people were murdered. And this is rather different because it allows me to get out of a framework of national history which is limited. Let me try to stress this point one more time. You can know everything, literally everything about Belarusian history. And I'm sure there might be someone here who thinks he does or she does. You can know everything about Belarusian history, but that wouldn't explain for you or predict for you why the Germans shot hundreds of thousands of Belarusian civilians during the Second World War. You can know everything about Jewish history, everything, but that still won't predict for you or explain for you why there was a Holocaust. The Holocaust can be described within Jewish history, and of course it has to be, but it can't be explained within the framework of Jewish history for the obvious reason that the power that brought it about wasn't Jewish power. The same thing goes for the history of the famine, for example. You can know everything about Ukrainian history up to 1930, 31, 32. You can know everything, and that won't explain for you why there was such a terrible and deliberate famine on the territory of Soviet Ukraine in 1932 and 1933, because the powers that were involved, the forces that were involved, go beyond Ukrainian history. So paradoxically, in order to understand national tragedy, to understand it, not just describe it, one has to go beyond the national framework, which I try really hard to do. Another metaphysic that I try to avoid, which will probably be familiar to you, is the idea of the teleology of the Soviet Union. That is, you can understand Soviet policies or justify Soviet policies by way of later outcomes. The most common version of this, and it's one which Molotov and Kaganovich and Stalin himself favored, is this. Yes, of course, we murdered millions of people in the 1930s, but we won the Second World War. And the implicit argument is, or sometimes explicit, precisely collectivization, precisely terror, allowed us to win the Second World War. Now, I think factually that's not true, but there's a more important point, which is that that's not historical reasoning. In history, you can't really say something happened in 1933 because something was going to happen in 1945. You can only explain things that happened in 1933 by events up to and including 1933. It's very tempting to apply later events. It's what I think of as the romantic fallacy, the way that Americans express this idea colloquially is that everything happens for a reason. So something terrible happens, and there must be some reason for it. Unfortunately, that's not the case at all. Or at least, if it is the case, it's the case in some metaphysical sense, which I don't think historians should be taking into account. We can only understand events in terms of the causes that bring them about. So I try very hard to avoid that kind of reasoning with respect to the Soviet Union, which still is quite frequently encountered. I also focus my attention on the center of the horror. So very often when these subjects are broached, the subjects of Soviet terror and Nazi terror, what people think of, what people's first references are the camps. And that's perfectly understandable. The Gulag and the Nazi concentration camp system were horrible places where many tens of millions of people suffered and a few million people were killed. But they were not the center of the policies of mass murder. In general, being sent to a camp did not mean that you were supposed to die. Being gassed or being shot or being deliberately starved meant that you were supposed to die. The camps killed a few million people, but the 14 million that I'm discussing here does not include people who died in the camps. If you add the people who died in the camps, that would give you another 2.5-3 million people in this period. But the total of 14 million are people who were deliberately murdered, shot, starved, or gassed. This all happened, and in a way, this also the camps distract us from this, because the camp system, the German camp system was partially in Germany, and of course the Soviet camp system was largely in Russia, Siberia, or Kazakhstan. But the place that I'm describing is the place where all of this murder happened. So I'm not describing people who were taken away somewhere else. I'm describing people who were murdered more or less where they lived. More or less where they lived, sometimes exactly where they lived. And by concentrating on this place, I'm able to see the victims, which is important, I think, both for the weight of the book and for trying to explain things, but also the regimes. So the book does go back and forth between Moscow and Berlin a bit, but it doesn't have the kind of problem that many books that compare the two regimes have. That is, I don't jump back and forth. The reader isn't expected to teleport back and forth between Moscow and Berlin. A chapter doesn't end in Moscow and then another one begins in Berlin. I avoid that because I'm looking at the regimes where they are exerting power, where they're exerting lethal power, where they're exerting their most lethal power, which is precisely in the Bloodlands. So we see Moscow and we see Berlin, we see Stalin, we see Hitler, we see Heydrich and Himmler, and we see Balitsky and Kaganovich and so on. But what we chiefly see are the institutions that actually carry out the murderous work, right? The Einsatzgruppen, for example, or the NKVD. And approaching matters this way means that I'm using sources which are not just from the central states. I'm using sources from the victims, most of whose languages I know, as Anna was kind enough to say, and I'm using sources from the institutions that were left oftentimes in the region itself. So where does this take us? Well, I think in our day and age, the most reflexive way to try to explain mass murder would be by ideology. So the Nazis killed because of Nazi ideology, or the Stalinists killed because of Marxist or Leninist or Stalinist ideology. And of course, that's true, and it's very important, but it's also quite incomplete. It's incomplete because it separates us from events rather than bringing us closer to them. What do I mean by that? Well, I mean that when we reduce ideology to just pure ideas, National Socialism, Stalinism, we're taking it out of historical context and we're turning it into something which is very easy, I would say, in some sense, all too easy to reject. It's very easy to say, in here in Illinois in 2011, I'm not a Nazi, I'm not a Stalinist, I reject those ideas completely. Of course, everyone does, right? That goes without saying. What's harder is to understand why it was that these ideologies had such power very often over people who were very much like us, or to put the point in the strongest possible form. We shouldn't delude ourselves into thinking that we would have resisted, all of us, these ideas had we been in a different time and a different place. And if that thought seems alien, then I just have to say we have to think more powerfully historically, because that's precisely the problem, that we reject these ideas, and we get, in so doing, we congratulate ourselves morally, which is what we shouldn't do. We have to try to understand. So what do we have to do with ideology? Four things, I think. The first is that we have to see that it only functions lethally when it's incorporated by institutions of power. So anti-Semitism doesn't kill people by itself. Anti-Semitism kills people when it becomes the official regime of an anti-Semitic state, Nazi Germany, and in particular when that anti-Semitic state goes to war. Those are two very, very important qualifiers. Likewise, despite what you hear on talk radio, Marxism does not kill people all by itself either. Marxism doesn't appear on the street and kill people. It has to be incorporated by certain kinds of Leninist institutions, and it is most at its most lethal when it's the official ideology of a Stalinist regime. Now, once you see that ideology has to be incorporated by institutions of power, then you can observe something else which is important, namely that ideology functions over time. And these two ideologies, which are themselves very different, were functioning on different timescales too, if you like. So for the Soviets, the most important revolution was in 1917. That was their revolution. It was also the world revolution, which was supposed to happen, but did not. And from their point of view, from Lenin's point of view and from Stalin's, what they were doing after 1917 was consolidating, protecting from what they regarded as a hostile imperialist encirclement of the socialist homeland. So it follows from this that they killed on a very large scale, but they killed within their own borders. And they killed at what we would consider to be peacetime, at times when they were not at war, actually, with anyone else. They declared that what was going on was war, a class war, or in the case of the terror, a preventative war against enemies. But there was no war in the conventional sense going on. For the Nazis, on the other hand, the revolution was in the future, for most of the book anyway. They are looking forward to war as the moment which is going to enable them to do the things which they always wanted to do anyway. Unlike Stalin, who inherits a state which already has a powerful, organized mass party, and which already has a trained, efficient apparatus of killing and oppression, the NKVD, which the Gepäu becomes the NKVD, Hitler comes to power in a republic, and he has to transform that republic into the kind of state that he wants it to be. And he believes, and he's quite right, that the only way to complete that process is to bring that state into war. That war will transform Nazi Germany, but more importantly for our subject here, it will turn Eastern Europe into the kind of empire which the Germans have always wanted, according to Hitler. What kind of empire is that? This is the third point about ideology, which I think is so important, and that is that ideology always involves economics. It always involves some idea of economic transformation. I think this may be the part which is the hardest to get across in the post-1989 world. I think the biggest intellectual mistake we made after 1989 was in throwing out the Soviet Union, throwing out Marxism. We also threw out the idea that ideas are rooted in society, that economics is rooted in other conditions, which it certainly is. If someone says, my ideology is not rooted in economics, you just have to ask who paid him to say that, because it's a completely ludicrous statement. To understand ideology, we have to see what kind of economics it's rooted in. Now, the point is not that the economics are nice economics or friendly economics or the kind of economics that we like or the kind of economics that Paul Krugman advocates in the New York Times. The point is that there is always an economic basis, and without that economic basis, the ideology doesn't make sense, and its murderousness is also impossible to understand. So, think about Soviet killing. Yes, the Soviets starved to death millions of people in the early 1930s. They shoot hundreds of thousands more in the late 1930s. This has something to do with class struggle and ideology, yes. But it also has to do with a plan for modernization. It has to do with a fantastically ambitious plan to take what the Soviet leadership itself sees as a backward state and make it into a modern industrial state as quickly as possible. Without that drive to modernize, none of this would have made sense. The same is true for the Germans. It's quite true that Nazi Germany was a racist state. It's quite true that it had racial classifications, which saw the Jews as the most dangerous, saw the Slavs as subhumans, and so on. But why is it that the National Socialism, why is it that Hitler is so interested in territories which are inhabited by Jews and by Slavs? It's not that he wants to go and kill Jews and Slavs per se. He certainly wants to eliminate Jews. He certainly wants to subordinate Slavs. But the reason why he cares about the lands that they live upon, is not just that they live there. It's not even primarily that they live there. It's that he has a vision of economic development, according to which industrial Western Germany has to be balanced by a vast, depopulated, agrarian, pastoral empire in the East. That is his vision of economic development. It's not entirely without logic. The idea Germany was not self-sufficient in food at the time, for example, which, by the way, is another point which is almost impossible to get across these days. We count calories, and we count calories because we don't want to be fat. Nazi planners counted calories because they were literally concerned that there were enough calories a unit of energy, after all, there were enough calories in the economy to keep men and horses and oxen doing the work that needed to be done. That is almost impossible to convey these days. And the reason, going back to economics and ideology, why it's so hard to convey has nothing to do with how we feel we think we're morally better than Nazis or Stalinists, whatever it might be. It has everything to do with pesticides, hybrids, and fertilizers, technical solutions to agrarian self-sufficiency, which did not exist and were not foreseen in the 1930s. And because they did not exist and were not foreseen, the only solution to agrarian problems seemed to be on the land itself. The Soviets had one solution, the Nazis had another solution. The Nazi solution was to take Eastern Europe, in particular Ukraine, which was seen as the breadbasket of Europe or the breadbasket of the world. So if you follow this logic, what you can see is that these ideologies, different though they are, end up focusing the two regimes on the same stretch of territory. What the two regimes have in common is not so much their ideas, although of course there are resemblances and a certain amount of imitation. What they have in common is territory. That's what they have in common. Both of them, and this is the fourth thing to see about ideology, the way that it fixes upon certain territory. Both of them have ideas about world transformation. The Nazis imagine a future war of the continents in which they'll defeat the Americans and the British and dominate the world. The Soviets, of course, are waiting for a world revolution. They have an international vision. But in the medium term, both of them realize that they can't break out of the box of Eurasia because of Great Britain, Another thing, along with food, Great Britain is the hardest thing to get across as a historical factor. At the time, Great Britain was the only superpower in the world, and in their different terminologies, Hitler and Stalin both understood that the Royal Navy was what was keeping them boxed in to Eurasia. The British, it's been a little while, the British are very modest, we've forgotten about this completely. But from the point of view of Berlin or Moscow in the 1930s, development, political, colonial, what have you, had to be in Eurasia rather than the wider world because of the British. So this means that if you can't conquer the world for the time being, you develop certain parts of Eurasia. From the Nazi point of view, that's Lebensraum, Eastern Europe, especially Ukraine. From the Stalinist point of view, in order to fund the transformation of your own country, in order to build what Stalinism called socialism in one country, you have to exploit the grain-growing regions. Again, especially Ukraine. So there's a territorial overlap in the ambitions of the two ideologies, and that's in the lands between, and in particular in Ukraine. Once this much is clear, it's not then surprising that between 1933 and 1945, the more people are going to be murdered in Ukraine than anywhere else in Europe, or for that matter, anywhere else in the world. You have to explain each policy, of course, but that general proposition that Ukraine is going to be the most dangerous place in the world between 1933 and 1945, I hope at least, becomes unsurprising once all of this is established. And at this point, you then just have to argue what the mechanisms were. There's another point which can be made here, and that is you can see from what I've said so far where the Soviets and the Germans could agree and where they couldn't agree. They could agree about Poland, because from the point of view of these two overlapping imperial schemes, Poland is just in the way. From both points of view, Poland is just in the way. Whether your scheme is Lebensraum or whether your scheme is collectivization of agriculture, Poland is just in the way. The independent Polish state is just an annoyance. On that much, Moscow and Berlin can agree, and they do agree, as we know, in 1939. They agree to remove Poland from the map in 1939. Where they cannot agree is Ukraine, because both imperial visions, both ideologies as they are put into practice, depend upon control of Ukraine. It's therefore impossible for them to agree about Ukraine, and therefore it's not surprising that Ukraine is a central theater of the war. Ukraine is where more people die than anywhere else. Ukraine is where the Holocaust begins. Ukraine is where famine is, and so on. So, once all of this is understood, it's then a matter of doing what I do in the book, in which I can't really rehearse at length here, and that is describing and explaining the individual policies which lead to the cascade, the escalating cascade of mass murder in this land. The first chapter concerns the famine in Soviet Ukraine. It argues that although the famine was not planned in any long-term way, it was deliberate. When collectivization failed, Stalin, for reasons of his own, blamed the Ukrainian nation, among other people, and made sure, by a series of policies which we can now chart and define quite clearly, that Ukrainians starved in 1932 and especially in 1933. The next two chapters concern the Great Terror in the Soviet Union. Now, the stereotypical image of the Great Terror is that of the show trials, that of the purges. These notions of show trials and purges are what come through to us from the press at the time, because the show trials were public, of course. They come through to us from Arthur Koestler, Documents at Noon. They come through to us from Khrushchev's secret speech, which concentrated on the party members, and so on. In other words, when we think of the Great Terror, we think of the kinds of people we might have known about, very well-known people, intellectuals, and so on. In fact, the Great Terror concerned workers and peasants. Workers and peasants above all. The two main actions in the Great Terror were the Kulak operation, which killed something like 400,000 people, most of whom were defined as politically suspect peasants. Who is a politically suspect peasant? A politically suspect peasant is a peasant who survives collectivization and survives the Gulag. That makes you politically suspect, because if you have survived collectivization and the Gulag, there's a pretty decent chance that you're not going to be a loyal supporter of the regime. Stalin himself came to this conclusion in 1937 as survivors of the Gulag, after five-year sentences, began to make their way back to, especially to Ukraine. The second set of actions of the Great Terror, which are most important, were the national actions. Something like 250,000 people were shot in ethnic operations in the Soviet Union in 1937 and 1938. There were about a dozen of them. The most important of them was the Polish operation, in which some 110,000 people were shot, each individually in the back of the neck, ostensibly for being spies of Poland. None of them actually was, by the way, as I'm sure you would assume. These actions took place primarily in Belarus and in Ukraine. The next part of the book is a kind of transition. Chapter 4 deals with the period when the Soviets and the Germans were, in effect, allies, the period between the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact of August 1939 and the German invasion of the Soviet Union in June of 1941. This is an extraordinarily important period. From the point of view of Soviet power, it's important because Soviet organs of power extend to the West. The Baltic states are destroyed, Eastern Poland is occupied and annexed, and the NKVD moves to the west. To give you a striking idea of what this means, in Eastern Poland, which as you will all know, is a land which is occupied, it's inhabited by Poles, Ukrainians, Belarusians, and Jews. In Eastern Poland, the NKVD makes more arrests in 1940 than it does in the entire rest of the Soviet Union, right? Which is like saying, you know, the police make more arrests in Evanston than the rest of the Midwest, or something like that. It's a very small part of a huge territory. But it's even this moment is even more important from the German point of view, because it is now, with the destruction of Poland and the German occupation and annexation of Western and Central Poland, that Germany begins to exert murderous power on a large scale for the first time. Up to 1939, political anti-Semitism had developed very far in Germany, but the number of people who were actually murdered was relatively small. I mean, horrible, that is, hundreds or maybe even a few thousand. But so on the scale of France, or United States, something dreadful, but compared to the Soviet Union, still a very, very small scale. It's in 1939, with a move into Poland, that German institutions, such as the Einsatzgruppen, for example, begin to kill for the first time on a large scale. And the German scale of killing in this period equals the Soviet scale, high tens of thousands, low hundreds of thousands. But the period is actually fundamentally more important, I think, even than that, because the period is marked by the destruction of states. Now, usually if we write the history of Nazi Germany or the history of the Soviet Union, we don't pay much attention to other states. We just concentrate on those two empires. But for me, it's very important when states are destroyed. You know, in America, we have this nice idea that the smaller government, the better. And, you know, I'm happy to entertain that idea, but there's a point beyond which it's not true, for sure. When there's no government, it's definitely not better. When the Polish state is destroyed, although some people see that as an opportunity, nevertheless, for the vast majority of its citizens, things go much worse than they did before. In particular, for its 3.3 million Jewish citizens, things go much worse than they did before. It's a dramatic change to have your state destroyed. It means you're no longer a member of anything. There are no longer any institutions to which you can appeal. For Polish Jews in particular, this means the beginning of the escalation of the Final Solution. Because in Germany, you see, in September 1939, only 0.25% of the population was Jewish. 0.25%. Once Poland, or half of Poland, comes under German control, suddenly there are 2 million Jews under German power. And what to do with them, from the Nazi perspective, becomes a pressing problem. So it is now that we begin to see ghettos. And it is now when we begin to see plans for how these Jews can be gotten rid of, which at this time means deportation. So this is a very important period, for all the reasons I've said, but also to just make a very simple point, because this is when the Second World War begins in Europe. The Second World War begins with a Soviet-German agreement. It might have begun some other way, but in fact, it begins with a Soviet-German agreement. And to that extent, everything which happens in the Second World War in Europe begins with this period. Now, in the final part of the book, the Germans are doing most of the killing. In the first part, in the 30s, the Soviets are doing most of the killing. 39 to 41, it's roughly equal. From 41 to 45, it's almost entirely the Germans. The Germans undertake three major policies of mass murder. The most significant of these is the Holocaust. And to understand the Holocaust, one has to understand what I've been stressing before, namely that you have a regime which is anti-Semitic, where political anti-Semitism has become very highly developed, which now suddenly can engage in its empire-building project, which is what the invasion of the Soviet Union is. The invasion of the Soviet Union is supposed to do four things. First, the Soviet Union itself is supposed to collapse within 2 months. Second, the Germans plan to starve 30 million Soviet citizens in the first winter of the war. Third, the Germans plan to carry out a long-term colonization project known as Generalplan Ost, which would involve the further deportation and enslavement of tens of millions of Soviet citizens. Finally, the Germans plan to use the invasion of the Soviet Union to complete what they think of as the final solution of the Jewish problem. As of summer 1941, what they're thinking is going to happen is that after they destroy the Soviet Union, they're going to push the Jews to the east. Many of them will die, many of them will starve, many of them will freeze. Some will be exploited, but that's the idea. What actually happens is rather different. What actually happens is that the Red Army digs in. First counterattack is at Moscow in December of 1941. The Soviet Union does not collapse. Starvation proceeds, but on a much smaller scale. It's very hard, actually, to starve people. You have to have the kind of political control that the Stalinist system had in Ukraine in 1933, which is very difficult to bring about. And, of course, colonization is all but impossible until you've won the war. So what the Germans do is they escalate and accelerate one of these plans. I'm compressing a big, complicated argument from Chapter 5. They escalate and accelerate one of these plans, which is the final solution. What they learn in the invasion of the Soviet Union is that it is possible to kill Jews on a very large number, that Germans will shoot them, and also that local people will shoot them. And this is something they did not understand. They did not know this was possible. The final solution is a process of learning where they realize that deportation is impossible because the Soviet Union fights back, and that was the last place they had thought of deporting the Jews, but killing Jews is possible. And by the end of 1941, about 1 million Jews had been shot. The second major German policy of killing is the starvation of Soviet prisoners of war and other Soviet citizens. which disproportionately touched the peoples of the Western Soviet Union, namely Ukrainians and Belarusians. And for many Ukrainians in particular who died in German prisoner of war camps in 1941 or early 42, it was the second experience of political starvation they had faced. Some of them who survived wrote about it as such. Some of them who survived wrote poems or even songs about the double experience of starvation. It's not surprising, I mean, it's a sad way to put it, but it's not surprising that this could have happened to them, because this was the zone, after all, which both sides wished to exploit in a form of colonization which was based upon food. But this policy itself is worth remembering in general. It's the second largest German policy of mass murder. Some 3 million people were starved to death in horrible, horrible conditions. This is an event which slips through the net of our national history, because the Soviet prisoners of war didn't belong to a nationality. They were Soviet prisoners of war, right? Of course they did. There were Russians and Ukrainians and Armenians and so on, but they're not remembered as such, and so we forget them. We forget them. There were 3 million of them. It's a very striking thing. So just to give you a sense of this, by the end of 1941, on the territory of occupied Poland, the largest group of victims of German power was not Poles, nor was it Jews. By the end of 1941, the largest group of mortal victims on Polish territory, were Soviet prisoners of war who had been moved westward, surrounded by barbed wire, and allowed to starve, which everyone observed at the time, by the way, including the Jews and the Poles, whose writings about this are among our sources on this event. The third German policy of mass killing were so-called reprisals against civilians, which were directly or indirectly related to partisan activity. These took place chiefly in Belarus, where hundreds of thousands of Belarusians were killed. The relationship between this and partisan action could be very, very indirect. So by the end of the war, the Germans were simply going from village to village and killing women and taking men, killing women and children and old people, and taking the men and the livestock back to Germany. And this was classified as reprisal action, but it was in fact just the act of an empire which needed labor power. The other major example of reprisals was in the Warsaw Uprising in 1944, when the Germans, during the uprising, but in actions which were totally unrelated to combat, killed at least 100,000 civilians. So those are the chapters of the book. Before we have a discussion, let me just leave you with a couple further thoughts about what the book is and what the book isn't. The book is not really a comparison. Now, that might seem like a surprising thing to say, but it's not. A comparison involves taking two things apart and looking at them separately, right? So I'm standing, you're sitting, I'm wearing a tie, most of you are not, and so on. That's a comparison, right? An interaction is something else. We're both in this room. At some point I'll stop talking and you'll start asking questions. That will be an interaction. The book is much more about interaction than it's about comparison, because it starts from the premise that its subject is lands where both Soviet and German power is present. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm claiming that everything is an interaction. I'm most certainly not. Some things are and some things aren't. And I think once you establish the basic, fundamental, and I think irrefutable reality that Soviet and German power were present on the lands where 14 million people were murdered, you then have to be very careful about where they were influencing each other and where they weren't. So the Nazis had nothing to do with collectivization in the Soviet Union, for example. The Soviets had nothing whatsoever to do with the euthanasia program in Nazi Germany, and so on. But one also has to be clear-eyed about where there were certain kinds of interaction. And by interaction, just to be clear, I'm not saying that the two are the same. I'm certainly not saying that you can reduce them down to some underlying reality, like totalitarianism, which is an idea with which I don't agree. What I am saying is that the two were present on the same territory, that what they had in common was territory. And in that situation, it's not surprising they would have influenced each other, right? It's really something which should be totally obvious once we think about it. So they influence each other a little bit in a conversation about economic development. The German ideas of economic exploitation of Eastern Europe were a kind of strange conversation with Soviet ideas. Because what the Germans wanted to do, and what they called their four-year plan authority, was to undo what Stalin had done in the five-year plan. The Soviets had built up cities, we'll destroy them. The Soviets had populated these territories, we'll depopulate them. And so on and so forth. The Soviets had built up factories, we'll get rid of them. Right? Another moment of interaction, which I've already stressed, is the Alliance of 1939. That's how the Second World War began. It's a very important moment for the peoples who lived in Eastern Europe. Even in 1941, when the two systems are at war, the interaction doesn't stop, because the two of them provoke each other to do things which alone they would not have been inclined to do or perhaps even able to do. I mentioned the Belarusian partisans, which along with the prisoners of war is one of the overlooked tragedies of the Second World War. The Soviets would in some cases deliberately provoke German partisans, German reprisals, because they knew that after the reprisals they would be able to recruit the survivors to the partisans. So the Germans end up doing things which they wouldn't have done otherwise. But there are moments when you can see an alignment of interests even during the war, and the classic example of this is the Warsaw Uprising, where Stalin knows perfectly well that the people who are resisting Germany in August 1944 will also resist Soviet power when it comes. That's perfectly clear because the people in question have said so themselves. They're trying to establish an independent Polish state or reestablish it between the departure of the Germans and the arrival of the Soviets. So it makes perfect sense for the Soviets to allow the Germans to put down the Warsaw Uprising, which they do. Or to take an example from beyond my book, the Gulag is truly lethal. It's always, of course, horribly dangerous. But in general, if you go in, you come out. 9 times out of 10. It's truly lethal in 1941, 1942, 1943. Why is that? Well, you can probably guess by this point. If you're in the Gulag in those years, it's because you were sentenced by Soviet authorities. But so many people died because of Operation Barbarossa, because of the German invasion of the Soviet Union, which cuts off food supplies to the camps, which are, of course, at the bottom of the list of priorities and leads to the death of hundreds of thousands of people. Are those people victims of Hitler? Or are they victims of Stalin? I don't think the question can really be answered that way. I think that's true for a relatively large number of people. You can't actually say that it was one or the other, and that's a bit what I mean by interaction. Now, I've said that my book is mainly about interaction, not really about comparison, but I don't want to dodge the issue of comparison, because I think the opposite view, namely, you shouldn't compare, you can't compare, you're a very bad person if you can compare, and so on. I think that view is highly dangerous, intellectually, morally, historically, every possible way. If historians actually had to go through the sources, applying the taboo on themselves that they couldn't compare, it would be very difficult to think, to read, to do anything, especially in a subject like this one. So if I read, for example, the memoirs of Jews about how in September 1939, when the Wehrmacht was invading from one side and the Red Army was invading from the other side, and they were trying to decide which way they were going to flee, and I forbid myself to compare, how on earth can I understand their world? Because their world, their prospects for life, depended upon comparison, right? And that is not just true of Jews in Warsaw in September 1939. It's true of Jews throughout this region, who, as long as they were alive, had some chance or some real experience with both systems. And it's true of Poles and Ukrainians and everyone else who had some kind of experience, real or anticipated, with both systems. People were comparing constantly. The first-person sources are thick with comparison. So to apply some kind of taboo on comparison would be a luxury of the present day, but it would be a serious injustice to the people who actually experienced the time and the place. The other thing which is worth saying about comparison is that the taboo is not an intellectually serious position. I think no one thinks it is an intellectually serious position, by the way. If I say to you, okay, I'm not going to pick on anyone personally, but if I say to you, you collectively, you know, bomb, if I say to you, you may not compare, it's a very bad thing to compare, don't compare, what am I really saying? If I say the two systems are incomparable, what am I really saying? I'm saying I, tie-wearing historian, have already compared, and I don't want you to compare. And I have the microphone. That's all I'm saying. The word incomparable is a comparative judgment. So anyone who says two things are incomparable has already made the comparison and then is asserting a power position, basically. So I understand that, I think I understand the reality of all this, which is that no one really thinks that the taboo is an intellectually serious position. People hold certain kinds of taboos for what they take to be moral reasons. They think, to take one reaction which I've had to this book, they think, if you allow Stalin to be compared with Hitler, you will inevitably understate the huge reality of Stalinist murder. Or, to take a position which is more common in North America, if you allow the Holocaust to take part in the same book with other events, you will inevitably minimize the Holocaust. I think the exact contrary is true. I'm a historian, I believe in history, and I think that if we want to remember either Stalinist crimes or the Holocaust, we should make very sure that we have them properly anchored in history. I think there's no other way to do it. And I think when we allow ourselves to fall back into defensive postures and taboos, we prevent history from happening. History which ends up demonstrating things which we might find very surprising. So for example, with the Holocaust, I'm now going to share with you my radical position on the Holocaust. Because I actually take a more radical position, I think, on the Holocaust in this book than has ever been taken before. That's not what the book is about particularly, but that's where you end up. For generations, historians of the Holocaust have been saying, on the one hand, the Soviets killed more people, but on the other hand, the Holocaust was a special racial crime. And only half of that is true. And it's the second half. The Germans killed more people than the Soviets did. And the Holocaust was a special racial crime. And I'm the first one to argue that. And why am I the first person to argue that? It goes back to what I said at the beginning of the book. You can only say things like that, you can only see things like that and say things like that if you bring together all of the histories into the same account. That's the only way you can end up being confident about those comparisons rather than falling back into a position of taboo and defensiveness, which I think is so undesirable. But I want to return from this excursus about comparison because, as I say, it's not really the central point of the book. What I say about comparison is secondary, and in a way, what I say about interaction is also secondary. What I've said about interpretation and even methodology is, in some sense, secondary. What's primary for me is the subject, and I'll feel like I'll have succeeded if I've conveyed by this book, and perhaps a bit by this lecture, the subject itself being humanity and human beings, be they who they were. The book is in part an attempt at a reconstruction, a reconstruction of individual humanity. The numbers with which we have been left are so huge, right? Whether they are 3 million famine victims or 5.7 million Holocaust victims or this number 14 million which I'm giving you, they are so big that we cannot really react to them. I mean, I would even say that 22,000 Polish citizens shot at Katyn is too big. I think we have a hard time even with 22,000. 22,000 individual executions, one after the other. That's hard. That's very difficult. 700,000 great terror victims. That's, I think, almost unimaginable. And then you move up to the next order of magnitude into the famine, the Soviet prisoners of war, the Holocaust. It is very hard. And so long as that remains very hard, we have before us an intellectual victory of Stalin and Hitler. They have left us with these numbers, with which or against which we struggle. And I think the only way to have some chance of making any sort of progress in that struggle is to apply a very conservative historical method, and that is to say that the reason why these numbers are important is not just that they're so big, it's because big numbers contain small numbers. So 14 million is not 14 million. 14 million is 14 million times one, where that one is not just an interchangeable unit, but that one is an individual who is different than the individual that came before and the individual who came after. In other words, the book is ultimately about people, and it succeeds insofar as it turns numbers back into people. I can't succeed with that in a lecture like this, but what I would like to leave you with is the names of the three people that I mentioned at the beginning. The young man in Ukraine who dug his own grave's name was Petro Veldy. The Polish officer who kept a diary's name was Adam Solski. And the young Jewish woman who left a message to her mother in Kolva was Dobcha Kagan. Thank you very much. Okay, I'm gonna start from right and move to left. So this gentleman.
Professor Snyder, why has it taken 70 years since the end of the hostilities, roughly, to write a book like this when it is such an important subject? I mean, I have my own theories and I'm going to expound on them. I wonder if you could perhaps answer that question if there is an answer.
Yeah. Well, the first part of my talk was an attempt add a partial answer to that question. You know, I note that we do have abundant histories which approach this subject, but each of which has its own internal limitations, each of which tends to struggle with other subject matters. And I would add in response to your question that this is entirely unsurprising. So in the first part of my talk, I'm not trying to say, you know, everyone has been unintelligent or unexpectedly sensitive. These are incredibly difficult and sensitive issues, and it's completely unsurprising that they would be closely attached to matters of national identity and political identity. So in other words, if I'm right that this is the worst catastrophe in the history of the West, it's not surprising that it would produce such tremendous difficulties in history, because history has a hard time getting hold of matters which are divisive and which are sensitive. And I would also add that we have to be careful about the standard of comparison. You know, much as I agree with you, and I find myself startled all the time that it hadn't been done, and you know, much as during the writing of the book I wish someone else had already done it, we should remember that in general good history takes at least 60 years. At least that's been my observation, that with 60, you need 60 years out from the event for the people involved to die and not defend themselves often, and you need 60 years out from the event to get access to sources. Even in a situation not as dramatic as the Soviet Union, it generally takes something like 50, 60 years to even have a chance at getting at it. You were next, sir.
You've identified some of the elements that led to the slaughters in that place at that magnitude. Can we take solace from that, that should today's population be faced with great stress if they would behave any better?
Well, my one-word answer is no. So I started out as a historian of ideas, and I do think ideas are very important. I do think they have their own logic, they have their own sources of appeal, they have the special feature that they can reach people who are of themselves articulate. All of that is true. But these ideologies in the time and place, they had their specific features which were not closely related to history, which were somehow accidental, but they also had their features which were very closely related to history. The fact that both the Nazis and the Soviets, despite their very many differences, were concerned about developing the land is no accident. It had to do with the fact that this was still an agrarian world. It had to do with levels of technology, and it had to do with the associated perception of environmental crisis. The environmental crisis was, we in Germany might not have enough food in the future. And that's, you know, the remark, I always say this about pesticides and fertilizers and so on, and I see people taking a brief nap, you know, as soon as I say the word pesticides, people take a 5-second nap, and then people begin to die again, everyone wakes up. But pesticides, fertilizers, and hybrids are the techniques that made the Federal Republic of Germany different from Nazi Germany. I mean, we can believe if we want that everyone in Nazi Germany learned their lesson, you know, but if we think about it just a second, we know that's not really true. The men and women who made the Federal Republic were the same men and women who made the Third Reich, with a few exceptions at the top. And it's also not the case that we're so wonderfully better than, you know, interwar Germans, or for that matter, interwar Soviet citizens. What we, most of us, I mean, generationally there might be a few exceptions here, but what most of us have in common is that we grew up in a time of abundance. And even if you stick to the example of food, that might be changing. You know, food prices are going up internationally. One sign this is happening in our big country is that restaurant portions are getting smaller. I don't know if you've noticed this, but if you haven't, start noticing it, because it's true. Portion sizes have gone down, especially of meat. That's because food prices have gone up. But in other parts of the world, this is much more evident. Like in Africa, for example, where mass killing episodes in the recent past have something to do with the distribution of land. And the fact that the Chinese, that it's not just the Americans or the Russians, but that there are many great powers who are in some sense aware of this, means that we may be entering into a similar moment. So China is already buying up land in Africa. China is buying up agricultural land in Ukraine, which is another thing that, if you don't know about it, is worth investigating. It's a very interesting development. The reason why they're doing this is they know that they're losing fertile soil. And they're thinking about a future with global warming. We can tell ourselves there isn't going to be global warming or whatever, but I think we are still in this. What I worry about is that we're in the same moment of environmental panic, where when you don't have a technical solution, you look for political solutions. And we don't have a technical solution to global warming. And so long as there is global warming, wet places are going to get wetter, dry places are going to get drier, places that have been fertile are going to cease being fertile, which is bad news for the Great Plains of the United States. And if you can't solve that technically, which is where I wish we would put a little bit more of our attention, then people start to have political ideas about how you solve that. And then I worry that we will be back where we started again. And I worry in particular because what the point that I was trying to make, it's a difficult point to make, that we use ideology to distance ourselves now, right? So we think, of course we're not Nazis, of course we're not Stalinists, we would never do anything like that. And I worry that that actually is counterproductive. Okay. Yes, sir.
Kind of a practical question. Sources as for local participation in basically Nazi operations. Are there actual sources of documentation available or easily available? I have not been able to find readings like that.
Well, yeah, that's the hardest part. The easiest thing is the high institutions. And then the second easiest thing, especially recently, since people have been paying so much attention to victims, are what we call victim testimonies, the first-person accounts of survivors. Not always, by the way, of survivors. I used a lot of first-person evidence in this book from people who actually died. And there's much more of that than one would expect. For the collaborators, for people who were neither directly responsible nor victims, it's quite hard. Because in general, that's a part of your life that you don't want to record.
Right. So there were official units, basically, the Polizei, for instance.
Yeah.
So with the German, would they have documentation?
And they do, but see, here the problem is, okay.
With the example of let's say, policemen in occupied Ukraine, these are very important people, because the Germans can't do without manpower. Right, and Ukrainians working for Germans, just like Latvians, Lithuanians, Belarusians, and so on, perform various important functions in the German Empire. But it's difficult. The Germans do write about them, and the victims, you know, Jewish or for that matter Ukrainian or Polish, write about them as well. The problem, though, is that, and you can see the problem, that the people who are getting these people to do their dirty work and the people who are suffering have certain inherent biases about why these people are doing what they're doing. They tend to over-politicize it, they tend to over-ethnicize it, right? So, yes, there are sources, but collaboration remains, I think, the hardest nut to crack. Partly just because in order to understand people's motives, you have to have you need them to talk about their motives. Even if they're lying, you need them to talk about their motives. And there's much less of that for collaborators than there is for people higher up. Okay, you in the back, sir.
In groups of the killing of the different masses by the Soviets and the Nazis, did each of them primarily kill different groups of people? For instance, the ruling classes, the intellectuals, or the random killings of different people through terrorization? Did each of them, the Soviets and the Germans, vary the way they were conquering the populations?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question, because for a long time, and Hannah Arendt is partly responsible for this, we thought of the regimes as being totalitarian. We thought of them as penetrating every nook and cranny of society, and in some sense, evenly terrorizing the whole population. The more we learn, the less that turns out to be true. It's really not true with respect to the Nazi regime, where so long as you were not active politically in your religion, so long as you were not Jewish, so long as you stopped being a social democrat or a communist or never were one, your daily life could more or less go on. I mean, up to the point where you got summoned to the Wehrmacht and, you know, died at Stalingrad. But in terms of domestic German politics, there was surprising continuity in most people's lives. German repression is hugely and overwhelmingly directed at certain groups of people. Mostly these are people who are outside Germany. So within Germany, in the so-called euthanasia operation, more than 100,000 people are killed. About 167,000 German Jews are killed. A few thousand Jehovah's Witnesses, who are pretty much the only group who categorically resisted National Socialism, were killed. But the huge proportion of the murder is outside Nazi Germany. It's in a war setting, and it's against people who have been defined as racial or colonial enemies or both. So with the Holocaust and its 5.5 million German victims, I say 5.5, the Germans killed about 5.4, the Romanians killed about 300,000. That is the biggest German war crime. It dwarfs anything that happened inside German society. Nothing like that happens inside German society. Soviet prisoners of war were seen as representing subhumans, people who are going to be starved in the long run anyway. And again, that dwarfs anything inside German society. When you read the reports of what the Germans are doing to Belarusians or Poles who are being killed, Serbs for that matter, who are being killed, they're describing people as though they weren't human. So it's not something which happens inside German society. What happens inside German society is dramatic. It's a complete political restructuring. But the violence is very unevenly distributed. In the Soviet side, it's much more like the idea of totalitarianism. People are much more afraid on a daily basis. They're much more likely to be observed by the state. So the Soviet state police is much larger and much, much, much better at learning about its population than the Gestapo is, which is small and pretty amateurish on this stuff compared to the NKVD. So the Soviet society is much more like that. But even so, Soviet violence, or at least lethal violence, is targeted much more than we would have thought. So the famine is a good example. The famine isn't expected, but when it comes, the death with which it's associated is directed pretty carefully. And then the terror is an even more striking example. We used to think the terror was, as you said, about educated people or party members, and it was about them to some extent, but it was really directed much more specifically in general against kulaks, these so-called prosperous peasants, and then against national minorities, and with quotas, right? So quotas would come down for how many people should be killed in a certain social class. And then that number would be killed, and then there would be exchange back and forth about the next quota. So even in the Soviet case, the violence is much more specifically targeted than we would have thought. Or when the Soviets come into eastern Poland or the Baltic states, they target people who are educated very specifically. People who are not educated, peasants, they generally do okay unless there's some specific reason where they resist. The people who are killed or deported are regarded as associated with the Polish state or associated with some pre-war political party. The targeting is actually fairly precise. So you can get, on the Soviet side, you can get to very large numbers of people killed and still be in a way discriminate, which is interesting. Yes, sir.
Can you discuss what you describe as competitive martyrology and how it might apply to Ukrainians, Poles, Lithuanians, and Belarusians?
Well, it's a general phenomenon. I mean, we're in the age of the victim. We're in an age which isn't particularly good at taking responsibility, and in an age which is quite good at identifying oneself with the victim. And identifying oneself with a victim generates a certain kind of political capital associated with the real or attributed guilt of others who are represented by states who might then have to do something for you. So the way competitive martyrology functions in that part of the world, but also that in general, is that you try to first make a qualitative point, we were innocent, and then make a quantitative point, an awful lot of us were killed. And since an awful lot of innocent people, or people who were, I mean, in my view, no one is innocent, that's a metaphysical point, but a lot of people who had no reason to be killed were killed, you know, in my view, about 14 million, you have a huge amount of raw material for this sort of thing, much more raw material than Americans can even vaguely understand, for the most part. Even so, or maybe precisely for that reason, you exaggerate to make sure that you're doing worse or better, depending on your point of view, than your neighbors. And how it works is historically structured. So in Poland, for example, the most dramatic example of competitive martyrology is the idea that 3 million Poles were murdered by the Germans, which isn't true. And no one has ever even tried to document it. That number was invented by Jakub Bierman, who is the most infamous Stalinist of Poland. And the reason he invented that number was to equal the number of Jews. So 3 million Polish Jews were killed. Let's say, I mean, he literally says this, let's say 3 million Poles were killed, because that way we can have peace at home, and that way the Holocaust won't stand out. He himself, of course, was of Jewish origin. His brother was murdered at Treblinka, as was much of his family. So it's not that he didn't know about what he was doing. It was a perfectly conscious political move. But then that number, 3 million, which is inflated, the true number is huge. I mean, the true number is between 1 and 2 million. The true number is absolutely horrible for the number of Poles who were killed. But that inflated number then finds its way into textbooks, and everyone assumes that it's true. I mean, up till the present, pretty much. Or, you know, in Ukraine, 10 million for the famine is the obvious example under Yushchenko, which, I mean, to my mind, that was a, just politically, that was obviously a complete bungle. Because when most people don't know that there is a famine, and then you give them a number which is wrong, people are going to continue to think there wasn't a famine. They're going to think you made it up, which is in fact what happened with that number. It was totally counterproductive politically. But then, putting politics aside, just historically, it's not a defensible number. Again, it's somewhere between 3 and 4 million, which frankly is big enough. I mean, that's large, that's so big that we can't really even understand it. And it's certainly enough to document and demonstrate the scale of the crime. On the Russian side, the big confusion, the big deliberate confusion, is between Russian dead and Soviet dead. Because, you will all know this better than most of my audiences, but the Second World War was fought not so much in Russia, although Stalingrad and Leningrad were very important, of course. It was fought chiefly in Soviet territory, in Soviet Belarus, Soviet Ukraine. So a disproportionate number of the military deaths were there, and a hugely disproportionate number of the civilian deaths associated with German occupation were there. And so whatever big number you pick for Soviet deaths, and I think they're generally exaggerated, but whatever big number you pick, it's going to be disproportionately Ukrainian and Belarusian. And the Russians are going to be massively underrepresented, at least civilians, because the huge majority of Russia was never touched by German power. But to get around this, there's a certain conflation of the Soviet Union and Russia which goes on, and that jacks up the numbers because people are counted as Russians who were in fact Ukrainians or Belarusians, or for that matter, Jews. And this is all complicated enough, that's what I get for hand gesturing. This is all complicated enough that no one in the West ever gets his mind around it. And even in the region, people have trouble sort of pinning it down. It's a tremendous effort. But it's clearly competitive, because once you establish that victimhood is a currency, then you want to have more of it than other people. And it's very hard to push numbers back down. It's really hard to push them down, because it's impolite. It's impolite to say that someone's number is smaller than it was, because then you must be dishonoring the victims in some way or another. So that's what I think is going on. And I think, by the way, the people who practice it are often quite conscious of what they're doing. I had missed someone here. Yes, sir.
You illustrated very well and very clearly the rationale of the Russians thrust into Ukraine as well as Germans. That's perfectly understood, but you had a perspective of 60 years. Analysis. To what would you, without having that advantage of 60 years, to what would you assign today, or attribute today, the trust of Russia into Ukraine?
I'm sorry, this is a difficult counterfactual problem for me. Yeah, so if it were 60 years ago?
No, as a historian,
yeah.
you can analyze very well what has happened 60 years ago. As you said before, you don't have this benefit today.
Oh, I see.
There is a trust of Russia into Ukraine. Why? What is the basis? There is no economic basis.
There's a what between Russia and Ukraine today?
There is a trust.
Trust?
Thrust.
Thrust. Oh, okay. I guess there's kind of both. Yeah, you're right. I don't have the advantage of 60 years. I mean, historians... One of the things I like about being a historian is that I think I have some chance of being right. I'm not sure I'm always right, but I think I have a chance, at least a chance of being right. When I look at reporters or political scientists who are trying to work on the present day, and I'm sure that, you know, most of them are wrong most of the time, because that, when you read the press, you know, when you're a historian, you read the press, you realize people had no idea what was really going on, right? So these 60 years is an advantage, and I don't have the same kind of expertise about what's going on right now. As far as Russian-Ukrainian relations, it's not at all surprising that Moscow takes a special interest in Ukraine. There is the idea, and ideas do have their own weight, that the Russian idea which confused the Soviet Union and Russia, you know, so that Ukraine and Belarus and even the other parts were in some sense part of Russia or Russian history. That's what people learn in schools, and that goes on. You know, it's not easy for Americans to think about the annexation of the southwestern United States, because we don't think about that. That's not how we're taught. You know, every time I drive into Oklahoma, I don't think, okay, when did we take this? When was it a territory? Because that's not how we learn history. And the Russians are no better. So they think of the whole thing as a kind of whole. They don't think about Kiev and the Rus and the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and Khmelnytsky. They start with the model they have. And so in that sense, the sentiment that Putin expressed, you know, that it was the destruction of the Soviet Union is a tragedy, it's not hard to understand why that would be a widely held sentiment. And then economically there are reasons, because Russia doesn't produce much. which it can sell internationally, but it does produce raw materials, namely oil and gas, and who controls pipelines and where those pipelines go is, of, as everybody knows, quite significant. And in order to have economic control over those things, it helps to have a good deal of political influence in Ukraine. And it's hard for me to imagine a Russian government which wouldn't try to have that sort of political influence. I can imagine Ukrainian governments which would resist, although it takes a certain amount of intellectual effort, but that's at least possible, right? So it's not that, that Russia would have powerful interests in Ukraine, that Ukraine would constantly be pushed back on the defensive. That doesn't surprise me at all. I mean, I guess the other thing to be said is that the obvious counterbalance for Ukraine since 1991 has been Europe. But Europe is not a geopolitical actor. Europe is not like Prussia in 1880 or even America today. It doesn't think geopolitically. It thinks in terms of its own internal structures. If you want to be close to Europe, you can't just say, we are pro-Europe, which is the typical Ukrainian policy. I mean, first you say, we want to get close to Russia, and that doesn't work out. You say, okay, we want to get close to Europe. That's what everybody does, basically. And that's what Yanukovych is going to try now. But the thing is, you can't just get close to Europe. It's not like a dance card, where you just write Europe on the dance card. You know, the Europeans only care about your domestic policies because they only care about preserving their own domestic policies as exemplified in the EU. So that's the only place Ukraine can go, and Ukraine hasn't, I mean, sadly, this is the tragedy of, you know, the Orange Revolution. Ukraine hasn't done that much to give itself a counterbalance, and without a counterbalance, then you're left with Russia. And Russia can forget about you for a while, as it does, but then it's always there and it comes back. Yes, sir.
I just have a question about the, as far as the numbers, as far as the Holodomor, the Ukrainian famine, like, what is some of the background, the methodology behind that number, and how do you reach the point that those who are saying a higher number are consciously exaggerating?
Well, it's a subject which can't be resolved with the kind of specificity that you can resolve other subjects. So for example, with the Great Terror, for decades we said millions, maybe even tens of millions, right? And we can resolve that in a certain specific way because we now have, thanks to the work of Russian, Ukrainian, other historians, we now have sufficient documentation to add up the different operations. And so the number 682,691 for 37 and 38 is probably off by a little, because no one can ever be perfectly precise, but I'm sure it's not off by very much. And the number of total people shot in actions of the Great Terror and like it, around 1 million, I'm sure is very close, very, very close. The famine is something different, because in the famine, people weren't killed individually, there was no individual record. And for that reason, it's not the kind of puzzle that can be resolved the way that, say, the Terror, or Katyn, for that matter. I mean, in Katyn, we now know that it's, 21,892, plus or minus a few, but it's very close to 21,892 because there are Soviet records of each person who was shot. With a famine, we're never going to have that. And because we're never going to have that, we have to accept that there's going to be a certain range of disagreement. And the question is, how broad can that range be and still be considered to be in good faith? Now, there are demographers working on this question on the basis of a fairly rich supply of documentation, and they have disagreements, you know, how you correct certain kinds of, how you account for the missing census of, what was it, 36? How do you correct certain things? How do you count how many people migrated as opposed to how many people starved? And those things, again, there'll never be perfect agreement about those things. But among the demographers, the range is now 2.4 to 3.9. I am not a demographer. I've read those studies. I think that the 2.4 is considerably too low, partly because that is close to what you would get if you just kind of, if you looked at the recorded deaths. And it's got to be much higher than the recorded deaths, because we know that many deaths weren't recorded. The 3.9 struck me as a little bit too high as well, because I think they didn't take into account sufficiently, I'm trying to remember what I thought about this, some migration issues, but I think it's in the ballpark. And by the way, the 3.9, that's the final Yushchenko number, okay? That's a number from a team of Ukrainian demographers working together with an American demographer of Ukrainian origin at the University of North Carolina. When they tried, you remember when they tried Stalin for genocide? Turned out to be guilty. When they tried Stalin for genocide in one of the least dramatic trials of all time, they commissioned a study, and that commission is the one that came up with this number, 3.9 million. And I know the people, or some of the people who are working on that, and I think, you know, I mean, I think they are doing good faith work, but it's also work just to make the point that it was commissioned by Yushchenko before Yushchenko went out. So 3.9 is not a number which somehow is coming from the far left wing or people who are not interested in the famine. So I think the range between 2.4 and 3.9 is probably about right. I also looked at contemporary estimations, and I also made some of my own estimations, and where I came down was at 3.3. And 3.3 was the number of people who were starved in Ukraine, but it also coincidentally is about the total number of Ukrainians who were starved, because a number of Ukrainians were starved in Russia, and a number of Ukrainians died in Kazakhstan, which we often forget. There were a lot of Ukrainians in Kazakhstan because they'd been deported there. So 3.3 is what I got. I am perfectly willing to accept that somebody who says that it might be 2.5 or somebody who says it might be 4 or 4.5 is arguing with good faith. When you go up to 10, I just no longer believe it, because there is no empirical basis for that. No one who's produced that number has ever, there are people who still defend it, don't get me wrong, but no one who defends it has made a serious attempt at saying why that number could possibly be right. So, and I'm not saying that everybody who believes it in bad faith. I do think the campaign to come up with 10 was probably, and I'm very sad about this myself as someone who cares a great deal about the famine, and as someone who personally is saddened that not enough people know about the famine in North America. I thought it was quite unfortunate that was the line that was taken originally. But anyway, that's my view. I think we're never going to get down to a precise number. It's a question of range, but for me the range is somewhere between 2.5, 4.5, and we should be debating within that range. Yes, sir. I'm just going to... Yes, sir.
Following up on the theme of interactivity, I was interested in your discussion of Polish-Ukrainian conflict during World War II, and it looked as if you were relying mostly on Polish sources to back up some of your conclusions. I was just struck by the relative absence of attention to some of the Ukrainian historical documents.
Like what in particular?
Well, I guess the archives of the Ukrainian insurgent army that have been published, I guess, since.
But I use those extensively.
Maybe I missed the citation.
No.
I mean, I don't know what, but I've written a lot about the UPA, and I don't know what you're referring to. In Bloodlands, the UPA Polish thing gets a couple of paragraphs, because the Bloodlands is about Soviet and Nazi killing policies. And, I mean, the interesting thing about the UPA and that conflict, for me, is that, in this discussion, is that it led me towards Bloodlands. When Ukrainians and Poles discuss the UPA and that Polish-Ukrainian ethnic cleansing of 43 to 47, they do it as though Poles and Ukrainians were the only decisive people, and that is sadly not the case at all. The UPA would not have been what it was without for 1, 2, 3 occupations. You can't really explain that ethnic cleansing in just in terms of national factors, and it was realizing that partly which led me to write Bloodlands. But no, as far as Ukrainian sources, no. I mean, like, you know, Potichny and I swap stories all the time. I read every single volume of that. And if you look at my work, you'll see that it's voluminously cited.
Unfortunately, it's...
Okay, sorry.
2:30.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I think we have to stop. One more brief question.
Very brief question.
Because I'm sure Dr. Snyder wants to sign a few books. And
okay, that's not a brief. It's not a brief question because it's not a brief question because when you say genocide, I don't know what you mean by it. And the problem with genocide, let's just be patient with this one, and then I'm going to stop. The problem with genocide is that people are operating using different definitions. There are some people who think that a genocide means a deliberate attempt to kill everybody. And then there's some people who know what the 1948 Convention on Genocide says, and they're aware that it's very broad. It includes things like, not just ethnic cleansing, but it includes things like educating children in a language other than their mother tongue. So what I think about genocide is that it's not a historical term. I try, in the whole book, there's a reason why I don't use it in the book, and the reason why I don't use it in the book, and I say this with apologies and as gracefully as I can, is that if you use it as a historian, then you end up having the conversation about what was genocide and what wasn't genocide, which I don't think is fruitful. I don't think it's fruitful, because the historian is then always forced to say, yes, all, and here's, I'll say what I think, all, there were all sorts of genocides. According to the 1948 convention definition, if we're going to apply it retroactively, before 1948, the Soviets and the Germans both carried out multiple genocides, many, many genocides. And I think the famine was genocidal. But I think lots of other things which were much less murderous than the famine were also genocidal. I think genocide, talking about it, leads us down a blind alley where people say, no, mine was genocide, but yours wasn't genocide. And I'm really trying to avoid that, and that's among other reasons why I use the term mass killing, which is a more drastic concept, actually, than genocide. And I begin a book about mass killing with the famine, which should tell you where I stand.
I'd like Mr. Misch to call. I'm going to introduce you to him. He's the head of the Holodomor Committee.
Okay.
And he, if anything, many years ago, was very instrumental in starting up the whole organization of Holodomor.
I'd like to inform you that in 2003, the Ukrainian Parliament voted on the genocide of Holodomor as a genocide, and they said it was 10 million people, not Yushin. Besides, just a couple of weeks ago, first president of Ukraine, Leonid Kravchuk, said that they have enough documents right now to prove that there are over 4.4 million documents to prove that there are victims after 78 years of space. Now, how can you explain? You were relying on Soviet documents, right? From Russia.
Yes, so are the people you're citing.
There aren't, this is an event, just, have you asked your question? Do I talk now? Okay, so all of the sources that you and I are discussing are Soviet documents. This is an event which happened inside the Soviet Union. There were people who wrote about it beyond the Soviet Union. For example, Ukrainians in Galicia, and I've spent a lot of time with those sources. But one simply cannot say that the Holocaust didn't happen because you're relying on Nazi documents, or the Holodomor did or didn't happen because you're relying on Soviet documents. This is an event which happened inside the Soviet Union. There are no documents which have been presented since the end of the Soviet Union which could possibly be relevant, because those documents would have been generated since 1991. And we're talking about an event which happened in 1932 and 1933. So we can disagree about what the documents say, but you and I and Kravchuk and whoever are all discussing Soviet documents. Now, Soviet documents are very partial because no one was interested in showing that there was a famine. And if you think that I'm one of these people who's trying to minimize the famine or trying to deny that it happened, you've misunderstood me completely. The question is how you understand the Soviet documentation that we have. And the Ukrainian Parliament voting in 1993 simply does not know as much as Ukrainian historians who have been working on the subject ever since. The consensus estimate among Ukrainian historians, is 3.5 million. You can't, just because a political body like a parliament votes on something, that doesn't mean that it's true. There are people, serious people, most of them Ukrainian, who have been working on this issue for 20 years, and the position, the number that I'm giving is very close to the numbers that they're giving. And we're all working with the same body of evidence. And we all think that it's something which is very serious and ought to be understood. I would drop 10 million as soon as possible. It's simply indefensible.
Most of the Ukrainian researchers are product of mass confusion.
No, that's actually not true.
Yeah, I'm not going to get back to you.